All right, sir. Well, first and foremost, my brother, welcome to Plastiq Magazine's Wednesday Conversations with Algernon. How you doing this evening, my brother?
I'm doing good, man. Doing good. Can't complain.
Good, good. Well, let's jump right into it, man. I've had a chance to listen to a lot of your sounds and what's been going on, and I can't wait to talk about some of these different things. All right. So when you are writing for other people, what's your approach in terms of telling sonic stories from the perspective of that artist? Like, how do you get into their POV?
Honestly, man, being around them or just like hearing them talk, tell stories about what they're going through, what they want, you know, hearing how they talk, their vernacular, their lingo, stuff like that. Like, you catch on to certain things, you know, you have to be the observer and, you know, you got to be a student and a fan of that person. And even if you don't know that person, it's just like, okay, you have to find the reason and the purpose of why you're there. So I think that's the most important thing, is just like, be a fan of whoever you're writing for. You know what I mean? You know, even if it's not your cup of tea, you got to learn how to, you know, turn that fan hat on and that student hat on to absorb, to really get, you know, the best product.
Okay. And that makes sense. That makes sense. And you've done such a great job writing and working for so many people. We're going to get into that in just a second. Your melodies are a wind tunnel of wonderful, sir.
Ah, man, come on. That's a bar right there. Wind tunnel of wonderful.
I'm learning from you, sir. I've been listening to all of your stuff and your pen. Razor sharp, razor sharp. We're going to get into that as we talk, but definitely a wind tunnel of wonderful. Talk about your creative process and how you come up with those beautiful layered melodies. How do you get into that zone?
Honestly, man, melodies first for me. Melodies always king. So, you know, sometimes God will bless me with a melody. You know what I mean? And I'm like, oh man, this is crazy. And then I'll lay down chords to it. And then sometimes, like a Looking for Love, I'll have the chords first and then I'll build the melody around it. But it all starts with like tonal stuff. You know what I mean? And so once I have like the tonal stuff down, then I can actually start laying down beats. But melody first, and really it's either God or it's either, you know, playing chords or hearing the chords of, you know, whoever track that is.
Nice, nice. Well, since we're talking about Looking for Love, that's one, that song is addictive. I've been playing it on repeat ever since I heard it. I saw a snippet of it, I think you had put online, and I said, what is this? What is that? It was just a disruption for me. I was like, what is this? I was like, oh, what is this? So tell me, how did that song kind of come together? I know you said you kind of started with the melody and such, but that is a beautiful song. Tell me about that.
Thank you, man. Looking for Love was very organic, to be honest. I came up with the chords first, like weeks before I actually even wrote something to it. I was down in Atlanta and I was working with a wonderful singer-songwriter by the name of Chase Farley. He's from Cleveland, Ohio. And so we were working, and so he was like, yo, Kev, like, you know, we've been doing all these track records. You know, we need to make something from scratch. He's like, all right, pull out the keyboard, you know. So I start playing. And so I was like, oh man, I remember this, like these chords that I had. He was like, get that. And so literally, like, you know, the melody started flowing as far as like just the hook of Looking for Love. And you know, we put it down and then we left it alone. But as we were playing it, I was like, this feels like something. You know what I mean? And he's like, really? I was like, yeah. I was like, I don't know how to explain it, but I was like, this is gonna be something. I was like, I don't know what it is. I said, but this is gonna be something. So anywho, left it alone, went back home, and like I felt like every week, you know, I would just tweak it, you know, from like, okay, let me add a verse, let me change out the drums, because the drums were very like weird and boxy. And then, you know, all right, cool. Let me add guitar. Let me add bass. Let me just, you know, so it was really like a love project in a sense of saying like, I don't know if this record is even going to make it onto the project, because my mind was set on something completely different. So the songs were different, and it wasn't until I did a survey. And so I figured out how to like digitally put records into a survey. And so from there, I let my audience and fans, you know, like kind of like close, you know, people listen to it. And the one thing that people just kept commenting on was like, looking for love, looking for love, looking for love. I was like, well, And mind you, Looking for Love was at the bottom of the survey, right? It was the last song. So, and I did it on purpose because I was like, this sounds like me. It really sounded like, I was like, this sounds like something that I would do. It sounds like a continuation. And I was like, I'm trying to, you know, branch off. But you can't ignore what people are saying. And so, you know, especially I'm giving it to the people that have my ear, right? So if they're telling me Looking for Love, I'm like, I got to reapproach it. And as soon as I started to reapproach it, I added on a record called Sweet Release. And that really was the, thank you, man. That was really the catalyst. That was the changing point to say, when I had Sweet Release and Looking for Love, that couple, I was like, oh, this is Drive 2. Let me now get into a mode to create this body of work, because now I have purpose, I have motive. And so none of that would have happened without Looking for Love and for the people that I, you know, trust saying that that was the record that I should go with.
Yeah, Sweet Release is just, that's just candy. It's just audio candy. Right. Boy, you put that on and you just lean back. That's all you need to do. Just relax your mind. Man, that's a mood right there, my brother. You did a fantastic job on that. How did you meet the iconic Troy Taylor? And what are some of the things you've learned from his prestigious University of Sound? I know Troy's a bad boy.
Yeah, man, TTU. I met Troy through 106 in Park. So like, this is like the end of the era, right? So, you know, Wild Out Wednesdays and all that stuff. So I was a contestant and I had to been no more than like 18, 19 years old. And he saw me on there, reached out on MySpace, Twitter. And once we got in contact, he was just like, yo, like, you know, whenever you come down to Atlanta, like, you know, we got to meet up. Sure enough, came down to Atlanta, met, and I told him, I was like, yo, I got like 2 years left of school. So, you know, I don't know what kind of, you know, work, you know, we go actually realistically be doing, but he's just like, yo, let's just keep in touch. So I was like, I bet. So as soon as I graduated and moved down to Atlanta and then started the whole process with Troy in the sense of really understanding how to evolve in the music industry in the sense of vocal production to even production to writing, how to approach a song, why you're approaching a song like this, what is the ear candy that people really like, you know, how to gain people's attention with certain melodies and cadences. It was all from Troy Taylor, you know, TTU. He didn't call it TTU back then. It was just Songbook, you know what I mean? But, you know, that's what I learned from him, you know what I mean? And during the time, you know, Trey was the hottest thing, like, smoking. You know what I'm saying? Like, this was Trey's songs, you know what I'm saying? Like, yeah. So, you know, watching him move around and navigate that, you know what I mean? Like, I learned a lot, you know what I mean, from him. And in my opinion, I think that Troy's one of the greatest. I think he is, you know, top two great vocal producers that's like still living on this earth. He just has the ability to bring things out of artists, you know what I mean, whenever he feels like it. Because, you know what I mean, like, you know, he don't just get up out of his house to vocal produce anybody, right? So, but when you do, you know, you're getting top level. I mean, this man won a Grammy by vocal producer Aretha Franklin. You know what I'm saying? So let's put that into perspective, ladies and gentlemen. Aretha Franklin.
You working with the queen.
No, the greatest voice of all time, as far as, in my opinion, technical wise,
right?
This man vocal produces her, right? Same thing right under her, Whitney Houston. You know what I mean? Vocal production with her. So he has a long history, 30 plus years in the game, and blessed to have him as my musical mentor. You know what I mean? God knew what he was doing when, you know, he had Troy Taylor to come into my sphere, because I mean, regardless of whatever business, you know what I mean, that may transpire for better or for worse, Troy is gonna be there. You know what I mean? Like, even when I decided to do my own thing, because we were in business together when I was signed to a major. But even when we all decided to part ways, you know, he was one of the ones, he vocal produced me on my first single. He, you know what I mean? Like, he's always been there and been a consistent force in a sense of like helping me and helping me to be, you know, the musical creative that I am.
Yeah, Troy's bad. No, I'm very familiar with Troy. I've known Troy's work since he was with the Characters back in the day.
The Characters!
I go all the way back to when he was in Jersey. When he was producing the Boys to Men stuff and all that. So I'm very familiar with how great Troy Taylor is. And you're very fortunate. And I can see his work all over what you've been doing.
Thank you, man.
Good. Audacity, Volume 1 and 2. Fantastic bodies of work. Can you elaborate on the concept of these albums and the process of obtaining the levels of freedom that you desired?
Man, audacity was truly what I was going through. I needed to be audacious to step out on faith. I asked for my release from my major label, you know what I mean? Versus, you know, most people get dropped, right? I left when things were building, right? So, you know, that was an audacious move, but I needed to understand how powerful I was in order to redistribute that power back to people that I trust. So with that being said, I needed a concept for the new project that spoke to my life, to be audacious. You know what I mean? Like, so, you know, I wanted to try different things. I wanted to try different sounds. I wanted to experiment. I wanted for people to get a variety. Hence why Audacity is such a, it's a wide range. It's a wide range of music. You know what I mean? Like, it's very like traditional R&B, got some trap stuff on there, you know, so it's like, it's a lot. But I, you know, as an independent artist, I wanted to make sure that I was going in the right direction in the sense to say, what do people like? You know, what are people going to gravitate to within this new sound that I'm creating? And, you know, Audacity, be loud, you know, be you, be authentically you, without fear. You know, walking into this new season of independence with no fear and no shame. And I think that was the biggest, you know, thing as far as like that was leading the charge for Audacity's Volume 1 and 2. And I'm very proud of it. Very, very proud of my first independent, you know, I guess string of records in a sense of Volume 1, Volume 2, and Audacity Complete. So, you know, I didn't mean for it to be a series, but hence COVID and just being able for people to digest the music properly, it ended up being a 3-part series, which is Audacity of 2020.
Very nice. Yeah, I enjoyed all of those sounds in terms of that, still spinning them. Now, how did you discover your passion for making music? Like when you were a kid, you know, what did you dream about doing with these talents?
I knew I liked to sing because my father sang. You know what I mean? The writing came later. The writing came at around 15, 16. The recording part came around that time too, 15, 16. My fascination with vocals, my fascination with backgrounds. I at 16 years old, I was in a part of like a show choir. And we did a string of shows where the Parks and Recreation paid each and every one of us like $1,000. So that was like the most money that I had seen.
Hey, not a bad day at the office.
That I could grasp. So, you know, most of the kids, you know, they went and bought shoes and clothes and this and that. Man, I bought this 16-track Yamaha recorder from off of a friend. And, you know, that was the start, you know what I mean? Because I would go over his house and instead of hanging with him, I would literally like be in his like, I guess like laundry room where the recording stuff was. And I would just be there, like just recording stuff, you know what I mean? So I was like, I know how to use this recording machine. Let me get this up off of him. And of course he hit me like for an insane price. He was like, hey, give me $1,000. Okay. I know it's not $1,000, but I'll
take all my little money.
Yeah. So, but it was, man, it was so worth it. It was so worth it in the end, just as far as like, man, I would be up all kinds of, you know, all times of the night, just recording and just trying to explore this machine. Great times.
Very nice. Tell us, you know, about this new project that you got dropping this month. What can we expect from this latest incarnation of Kevin Ross?
Drive 2 is an all-purpose project, which means that, you know, as soon as you press play, you understand what ride you're on. It's a very smooth and easy ride. It's compared to like a sweet hug, you know. It's an embrace that, you know, you can wake up to it, you can go to sleep to it, you can clean up to it, you can do whatever you need to do with this project. And it's something for everybody on there. It's definitely more, it has a more focused sound than Audacity. You know what I mean? I tap into a particular sound. This is the most that I've produced on a record, in a sense of like truly from like through and through, like beat, chords, yada, you know what I mean? Like, I think I produced maybe 80% of this project. Wow. So from Looking for Love being written and produced, and co-written and produced by me, and Sweet Release being produced and written by me, that this was a task, because I've always produced records like maybe one or two on a project, and thank God they've always ended up being kind of the focal tracks. Like Long Song Away is written and produced by me. God is a genius, right? So like these records, thank you. So I was like, you know what? There's a theme here that a lot of the records that people really like by me are the things that I'm producing. So Drive 2 really introduces everyone to, you know, what they would expect if I were to ever do a 100% through and through written and produced by Kevin Ross project, which I will do, not right now, but eventually I will.
It's gonna happen. I mean, but we're gonna take it as this one being that we're gonna.
Yeah, it's the prequel. And listen, we over 50% on this one, but it's great, man. It's great to just, you know, to have that kind of autonomy. It takes a lot of time. I ain't gonna lie. I ain't gonna sit there and lie to you. Yeah, as far as like through and through, like producing these records, but it's worth it in the end when you really hear it and when people respond to it the way that they do, and like it makes it that much better.
Yeah, now you definitely put in the work. Now, please remind people of which instruments you play, and then talk about the process of being disciplined enough to master them or master, you know, aspects of them.
Yes, master aspects for sure. I play piano. And I play guitar, and I'm able to play piano out in public. So I can say I play keys.
Okay.
Guitar, I'm still a studio guitarist. Okay. So I'm still, you know, play two chords, stop, punch in, play two chords, you know what I mean? And punch in. But yeah, I mean, I think the importance of at least having some level of instrumentation, you know what I mean, under your belt, it allows for you to understand musicianship as a whole. And not just, you know, if you're a singer and you're like, you know, this is what I do and this is all I know, it's like, forget all that. Like, you need to learn some level of, you know, or whether it's piano, guitar, whatever, so that you understand and you can relate and you can communicate with the musicians that you're working with, because that's a whole different language. You can't say, yes, this chord, that's have the decency to at least call it out, to say, if it's your song, know the chords to your song. Yeah. You know what I mean? Know what key you in. You know what I mean? So that the respect is mutual. You know, a lot of times you'll run into musicians, especially like when dealing with me, if they never met me before, then they're always in for, sometimes it's a rude awakening, or sometimes it's a pleasant surprise. But either way, what happens is, because it's R&B, you know, they'll listen to the music kind of, sort of. So they'll listen to maybe like the first 16 bars and be like, right. Yeah, I know this, we good. So when we get to certain points and I'm like, oh, here goes a chord change, and I can call it out, like, oh, okay, B flat major 7. And they be like,
oh yeah, okay, I'm not just a singer.
I see it. So it's a different level of respect where they know they can't get away with it. They know they can't get away with it cheating it. So if they have a bad show or they hit a bad note, they know that I know. So they'll look and be like, man, we gonna get them better next time or whatever. So they understand that it's like, listen, like, I appreciate you guys and understand that it has to be mutual. So I encourage each and every singer or rapper, because now rappers are even learning how to play. Roddy Ricch, he'll get on some keys and play and flow. D Smoke, he'll do the same thing. You know what I mean? So the game is getting a lot more diverse. So we as creatives, whether we rap or sing, man, you better learn how to play some. You know what I mean? Like, even if it's not at a proficient level, like, at least allow for your fingers to touch it. You know what I mean? So that you understand what it is.
No, that makes sense. That makes sense. Yeah, I'd love to see the looks on people's faces when you're in the studio and they go, oh, he's definitely more than just a singer. Okay. I like that.
Yeah.
Now, what are some of the things that you learned about yourself during this pandemic? I mean, we've all kind of had our own little journey with this particular thing, and especially as an entertainer who spends their life on different stages entertaining people. How have you been able to adapt and how has it impacted you overall? And what's some of the things you've learned about yourself?
Man, connecting with people has been like a big thing for me, like checking in with family. But then it translated to the stage because I was just like, yo, I've been away for so long.
Yeah.
I don't want it to be a thing where it's like, oh, it's cold, I can't touch you, I can't be around you. Ah. Like, it's like, no, like, you know, we've all taken the precautions. You come out and you've gone to whatever lengths that you went out to come and see me. It's not the normal lengths. So every time I see these hundreds of people come out, these are at great lengths. So I have to show a level of gratitude. I have to check in. I'm not just singing just to go through the motions of it or to do the thrills and the tricks of singing.
Right.
It's like, nah, like, I need to connect with you. And I need for you to know that I'm here with you. And I need to make sure that you're here with me. So if you and my range of view, you know, the first two or three rows, and I see somebody on their phone, I'm gonna keep singing. But if I catch a slipper, I may go out to the audience and tackle just to make sure that they're engaged, because it's like, we're so used to this. We're so used to being on a laptop that now it translates into public places. And one thing that I want to make sure that the audience understands is like, as much as I'm here to entertain, I'm here to engage with you. And I want to make sure that we connect on a level that is just beyond me just doing the song and dance for you.
Right.
There's a certain level of relatability that I want to strike within the audience that desire has never been more profound in my life than post-COVID. Or yeah. I don't even know if this is post-COVID, but like...
COVID-ish.
Yeah, like the latter part of...
Right, right. You know hopefully, I mean? Hopefully the last leg, but we'll see.
Yeah, the last leg of the pandemic. So, I would say just being able to connect. Connecting has changed for me.
Fantastic. The list of people you have written for and worked with is extensive. Who is still on your list to work with that's currently in the marketplace? And I asked you that.
Yeah.
I saw another interview where you talked about the legends and the icons that you would love to work with. And I'm with you there, especially Stevie. He's still with us.
Yeah.
In terms of whoever's in the marketplace right now, who would you like to work with?
Ari Lennox, for sure. Mm. Jhené Aiko, definitely. Ty Dolla $ign.
Like
who else? Hold on, I just want
to... No, no worries.
Somebody's calling. Sorry about that.
Nah, no worries.
Hold on, one sec. Hey, I'm on an interview right now. All right. She's embarrassed. No, I'm joking.
No worries. It's all good. It's all good.
Yeah, no, it's all good. So we got Ari Lennox, Ty Dolla $ign, Jhené Aiko. Man, it's so many dope people right now, man, that I'm, and even producer-wise, D Mile. Definitely want to work with a D Mile. Definitely want to work with a Camper. So many people, man. Like, you know, but just off the top, those for sure. Tiwa Savage for sure.
Yeah, I saw your remix there because I reposted it on my story as well. Because I was just like, oh, I like this. This is just
I had to throw that into the universe and be like, see if she could catch it. You know what I'm saying? She caught it. So hopefully that transpires into, you know, further collaboration. Honestly, man, and I'm gonna just put that out into the universe too. I did a record. This is my first Afrobeat record that's coming out on Drive 2. And you know, let's go. you dig what I'm saying? That's where I'm trying to go. Afrobeat. I'm trying to go to either Nigeria or, you know what I mean, some country in Africa. I need my feet on the soil.
On the soil of the motherland. You want to put your feet on the soil of the motherland where it all began.
Listen, I have to make it my mission. I have to make it my mission next year that, now ideally, I want for my trip to be paid for through music, but one way or another, I gotta get out there, man. Cause you know, I mean, outside of just like T-Wiz fans following me now, it's the energy, of the music, the energy of just, you know, I'm fascinated, I'm intrigued, you know what I mean, and I now want to actually explore that. So 2022, one way or another, Africa, here I'm coming. I'm just deciding on whether I'm going west, east, north, or south. I don't know. But I know I can't do it all in one trip. So I got to pick, you know, somewhere.
I got you. Go to west. Go to West Africa. That's where that's the Afrobeats block party that's currently going on right now. Niger. It's all about now. It's all about Lagos, baby. But now I went to a WizKid show last week.
Nice.
It was great.
I believe it.
All about the Afro beats. I was like, more of this.
Yeah.
In terms of that. For people, and since we're kind of on that, for people who are just discovering your movement, can you describe your musical, you know, aesthetic? You know, what can they expect when they stream your sounds? Like, if someone's never heard of you, as I think you said, you're still a discovery, you know, artist.
Yeah.
How would you describe, you know, your sound and everything for someone who's never listened to you?
The one Mandalorian. You know what I mean? I am a bridge. You're going to get a lot of old school stuff. You'll get some present day stuff, but all of it is geared towards the future. How do I move the genre and the culture forward musically doing my part? So I'm a bridge. Like, my base, my audience is very unique. It is made up of those that are my age, so late 20s, early 30s, to the aunties, 50s, 60s, you know what I mean?
And the uncles, sir.
And the aunties, uncles, grandmamas, you know what I'm saying? Like, that's my base. So to put it into perspective, on Instagram, I may have 167,000 followers. But on Facebook, I got 420,000 followers, right? So that's a huge gap in the sense of auntie and uncles really dominating the audience scene, in the sense of when I go to, or when I do my shows, that's who's there. The aunties and uncles. And I say that in respect. I say that.
No, I got you. I'm one of the uncles, and I'm not. I'm good. I'm
100%. Hey, bro, listen, you don't look like no uncle, man. You know what I'm saying? You a cousin for sure.
Hey, I'll take it all day. Now, I turned 47 a week or so ago.
You a cousin, bro.
All good. But I come from that R&B era, that rich R&B era. So I was attracted to you immediately. I was just like, okay, this kid's making good music.
My God. But honestly, I'm a bridge, man. So if anybody who hasn't heard me, you know, I'm just one that can multi-generational, and I can bring a lot of people together within music.
Absolutely. For upcoming singers, songwriters, what is the best piece of advice you can give them in terms of building their brand and their following? Because everybody, you know, has something they're trying to do. People are trying to get into the game. What's your advice, especially in this particular market, as to singer-songwriters, what they can do to really get out there and build their brand?
Be fearless. Be willing to collaborate. Be willing to adapt. Be willing to reinvent. be willing to accept no.
Yeah.
And always remember that whatever it is that you're thinking in your head, you're right. So endure it. Make sure that you have fun. Like, the destination is not the most important part.
Absolutely.
You know, it's the journey. So if you can't have fun while you on this, it's a long journey. I hope everybody understands.
It is.
It's not short. I've seen many peaks and valleys. I have number ones in rhythmic, urban, every chart you can name as a writer, producer, whatever. I have number ones of my own as an artist and R&B or whatever. The thing is that with every accomplishment, it's new levels and new devils.
Right.
So it's literally like every time you reach a point, it's like you're starting over again.
Right.
So it feels like, even though like people around you be like, oh my gosh, you've done so much and your life has changed.
Right.
You never want to get comfortable. You never want to do this, but it's always like, if you got to make it fun. If it's not fun to you, take a break from it for a while, reinvigorate yourself, rediscover why you love it. But if you are not having fun, this will be a terrible, terrible journey for you. It's not fast. It doesn't come fast. It's not easy. This is not easy money. It takes a while. So enjoy the journey. Have fun.
That is fantastic, fantastic advice in terms of that. And last one here. Some of your biggest artistic influences. I heard you're a Stevie fan, so we definitely have something in common. I'm a huge Stevie fan myself. Tell me about some of the other artists that you've been influenced by.
Mr. Marvin right there.
I see.
I got Michael over there. You know what? And then, you know, we get into the Freddie Mercury's.
Queen.
Yeah, man. We get into Patrice Rushen.
Love Patrice. She was not only a great singer, but she was also a great musician. Yeah.
Come on. Like, I want for, especially, like, I always tell this to especially black females within the music industry, is to always look up Patrice Rushen. Even if it's not your cup of tea, she was a pioneer for her time to be one of, you know, one of the few black women within the industry to be writing and producing and performing her music. She was rare, and it's very bizarre that she slept on as much as she is. Forget Me Nots is a smash. And then Will Smith made it a super smash. So it baffles me with people like a Patrice Rushen, Joni Mitchell, who's an amazing vocalist and lyricist and just artist in general. I mean, of course, your Prince, your Maxwell's, your Babyfaces, Smokies, you know what I mean? Like, even down to the modern day artists, your Neos. I'm trying to think of like somebody who just has a deep, profound. I mean, it's a lot of them. I will say that. I'm a fan. I'm just a fan of music. So, you know, Thundercat is another one that's crazy. Man, there's so many people, man. But yeah, so it goes on and on.
Good. Well, listen, truly, you know what? One more.
Yeah. Come on, we got time.
This new album.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
What do you want people to take away from this body of work?
That is more where that came from. And I'm in this for as long as God wants me in it. You know what I mean? I think I'm very clear that no man or woman can take me out of this industry. That now it's more so a decision. You know what I mean? That, you know, I live by my own terms. I work by my own terms. My success is by my own terms now. So that's the greatest thing to me, is the fact that Drive 2 is a statement to say, I've had peaks and valleys, but I am here. I'm here for a while.
Yeah.
As long as God has me here, I'm here for a while. I ain't trying to go nowhere. I'm not going nowhere. And I'm a artist and a brand that you can rely on. I want to make memories like the way Frankie Beverly made, or Earth, Wind & Fire. I see those shows and I see those people that may be 60, 70 years old. I see see them come to life again. It's like I see their spirit turn 20 again. That was crazy for me to experience that. Where I was just like, that's what I want. I was like, I want to give my generation part of that. So that right now, it's a plan. I have a plan. And that plan is like, technically it's like 7 to 10 years, right? So part of that plan is I'm in a unique space where I cater towards more adult contemporary stuff.
Yeah.
But my mission is to grab my generation and lead them into theater and to lead them into a place where right now we're in standing room only, so we're at festivals and we're sitting in the grass. And that's cool. That's not me. So I have to now curate music that allows for them to, you know, kind of string them along and say, it's some stuff over here because we're starting to change. These people are starting to have kids and develop families and stuff like that. So they don't want to be standing on their feet. They don't want to be going to no festivals of thousands of people, right? you may want to just go out with your, you know, with your woman or with your man and dress up and feel nice. Yeah. You know what I mean? Make somebody feel special by getting tickets to go see a Luther Vandross or Maxwell, right? You're going to pay top dollar for that because you know what you're getting from out of that. So right now, it's a gap and it's a hole because everybody's fighting to still be young. So for me, I'm grooming myself for what is to come. So the music will be indicative of what I'm trying to build within the next 7 years. So without saying too much, that's where I'm at.
You did a fantastic job in terms of that. I love everything that you're doing in terms of your movement, art society, everything like that. I love how you're putting it all together. As I said earlier, your melodies are addictive. I love the track that you're on. I'm definitely drawn to that old school style with a new school bend to it. I think it's absolutely dope. Your musicianship, your passion, and your way of communicating, and more importantly, your pen. very, very impressive, sir. So I wish you nothing but continued success. And I think I'm going to be at your November show here in Atlanta. I think you're coming
to
City Winery. And I did get an invite from your PR there. So I'm going to come through. I'm looking forward to it. Now that I've had a chance to really listen to all of the music, I am excited. I'm bringing my wife. We're going to spiff up a little bit, a little something, something.
We're going to
come see you, baby.
And let me know. Let me know how you enjoy the show, man, because this is what I do it for. I do it for the lovers. I do it for the couples. I want to make sure that you guys have a good time. So please come out. Yes, I do have shows. If y'all want to know about the shows, KevinRossMusic.com. Go and check it out. Looking for love. We number 11 on the R&B Billboard charts right now. We finna crack this number 10. It's Indy, baby, so we doing it.
I love it. Well, listen, I appreciate your time. I appreciate your creativity. Keep going, my brother. Can't wait to see you in November. I'm gonna come talk to you as well, all right?
My God.
Take care, bro. Appreciate you.
All right.